Erythromelalgia is a condition that is characterized by a triad of erythema, worms, and recurrent burning pain. Most commonly, erythromelalgia affects lower extremities, and less commonly the fingers and hands. Erythromelalgia occurs in episodes and typically bilateral. So once episode occurs, both extremities are affected. But between the episodes, the affected area is typically normal. Erythromelalgia can be primary and secondary. The most common erythromelalgia is secondary, which is caused by thrombocytosis. We have two conditions where platelet count is extremely high. It's polycythemia and essential thrombocytosis. In both these disorders, there is a significant risk of microthrombi formation. And important that in this situation, aspirin is the drug of choice. So let's discuss the pathogenesis of secondary erythromelalgia. So there is arterial vessel, and blood vessels have receptors that in response to irritation provides response in form of pain. Such receptors called nociceptive receptors, and one of such receptors are voltage-gated sodium channels. And usually, to trigger pain, something has to provide significant stimulation of such receptors. For example, usually, if endothelial injury occurs, platelets come to the site of injury and adhesion occurs. After platelets release thromboxane A2 that promotes aggregation, so more platelets come to the site of injury and their aggregation occurs. And aggregation results in formation of a platelet plaque. Then secondary hemostasis makes from a platelet plaque a thrombus. So, as we see in normal condition, endothelial injury do not cause pain, because in normal condition we have normal platelet count that provides formation of a small platelet plaque, and this results in formation of a small thrombus. But what happens in polycythemia or essential thrombocytosis when platelet count become extremely high? Generally, the higher the platelet count, the more active becomes primary hemostasis, especially aggregation phase. So now, in response to endothelial injury, because the amount of platelets is higher, platelets will form significantly bigger platelet plaque, from which secondary hemostasis will form a much bigger thrombus. The major problem is that a bigger thrombus will cause obturation of the blood vessel, and obturation will cause decrease in blood flow through this region. Because recall that flow is equal to pressure difference between the proximal region and distal region divided on resistance between them. And resistance is inversely proportional to the force power of radius. So with obturation, radius of the vessel decrease. With decrease in radius, resistance increase, and thereby flow through this region will decrease. With decrease in flow, fluid begin to accumulate proximal to obstruction, thereby the volume of fluid increase, and with increase in volume, hydrostatic pressure that acts on blood vessel wall will increase. And hydrostatic pressure begin to distend blood vessel wall, and the distension of the vessel will stimulate nociceptive receptors as voltage-gated sodium channels. Nociceptive receptors send this signal as electric stimulus. As any receptor, they have a threshold of excitation and they have arresting potential. And their significant stimulation will cause electric stimulus that will reach a threshold of excitation, and this will provoke an action potential. And exactly the polarization of nociceptive receptors triggers pain. Pain will provoke vasodilation, so more blood will inflow to affected region, so the higher will be the volume of arterial blood. And this will cause erythema and worms. Also, because blood flow to peripheral regions becomes disrupted, this will cause ischemia of peripheral tissues. First of all, ischemia will cause pain, and in severe cases, prolonged ischemia causes formation of distal ulcers. So we have all the key features of erythromelalgia. It's pain, erythema, and worms. And in addition to this, distal ulcers as the most severe complication. Which factors most commonly provoke erythromelalgia? And actually it's physical exercises. The reason is that with exercises, cardiac output increase. With increase in cardiac output, blood inflow to the affected region increase. so the volume of blood in this part proximal to thrombus increase. This cause increase in hydrostatic pressure. Increase in hydrostatic pressure cause vessel distension. Vessel distension provokes pain, and pain lead to erythema and worms. Actually, when I think about erythromelalgia, it's the first association that comes to mind. And guess what? One of the most effective options in treatment is basically cooling the affected extremities. But we have to know that the drug of choice for secondary erythromelalgia is aspirin. The concept here is that aspirin inhibits the function of COX enzyme. This causes decrease in thromboxane A2 production. Decrease in thromboxane A2 inhibits aggregation. The lower is the aggregation, the smaller is the size of thrombus. So the lesser will be the obstruction. Thereby the lesser volume of fluid will accumulate, and now it will cause subthreshold stimulus that will not trigger depolarization. No depolarization, no pain. No pain, no erythema and worms. So for secondary erythromelalgia, just take an aspirin pill. Primary erythromelalgia is an idiopathic or inherited disorder, also known as autosomal dominant neuropathy or aspirin-resistant erythromelalgia of unknown origin. Guess what? Here aspirin does not help. And to explain why, we have to know the pathogenesis. The problem is that in primary erythromelalgia, due to a mutation, the nociceptive receptors becomes extremely sensitive.
You're sensitive, born itomate.
So we have a chromosome 2, and on chromosome 2 located STN gene that encodes alpha subunit of the voltage-gated sodium channel. Basically, gene is a number of nucleotides that form DNA molecule. DNA molecule consists of two strands. And to use the information in the gene, information must be carried to ribosomes where proteins are made. So DNA molecule, for this purpose, makes a copy of the gene in form of parametric RNA molecule. Let's suppose that our sequence of nucleotides located in a coding region that's called exon, so this sequence of nucleotides will not be removed by RNA splicing, and in form of matrix RNA molecule will be delivered to ribosomes. Ribosomes read nucleotide sequence in matrix RNA molecule in codons and include complementary to that codon amino acid. In this case, it's valine and glycine. And a particular amount of amino acids form protein. In our case, this protein is alpha subunit of the voltage-gated sodium channel. And alpha subunit and beta subunits together form complete voltage-gated sodium channel. And usually, when endothelial injury occurs, even if we have a normal platelet count, in some cases it will cause formation of a relatively big thrombus. With obstruction, blood flow decreases and blood begins to accumulate in the proximal part to obstruction. This will cause the distension of the vessel, and distension will cause stimulation of nociceptive receptor. But because the size of a thrombus is not big enough to cause significant accumulation of fluid volume, the distension is not that significant to cause a stimulus that will reach a threshold of excitation. So there will be no depolarization, and no depolarization means no pain. The problem in erythromelalgia is that mutation in STN gene occurs. Let's take as an example some random mutation as single nucleotide polymorphism. This mutation substitutes one nucleotide in DNA structure with another nucleotide. So in DNA molecule, due to a single nucleotide polymorphism, guanine is substituted by thymine. Thereby, in non-coding strand will be adenine, in matrix RNA molecule will be uracil, and now the triplet, triple uracil, encodes not valine, but phenylalanine, which is totally different amino acid. And different amino acid results in production of a partially different protein. In our case, it's alpha subunit of the voltage-gated sodium channel. And affected alpha subunit results in production of affected sodium channel. But how this mutation affects the function of the sodium channel? And the concept is that this mutation simply decreases the threshold of excitation, and this creates a huge problem. Because now, even minimal stimuli will provoke pain. For example, minimal stimulus of the receptor due to a vessel distension now will reach a threshold of excitation. This will cause depolarization of the receptor, and this depolarization causes pain. So basically, the receptor becomes more sensitive. So previous subthreshold stimulation that normally just goes unnoticed now causes depolarization, and depolarization causes pain response. So the major problem in primary erythromelalgia is hypersensitivity of receptors. And interesting that such mutation is inherited as autosomal dominant trait. So erythromelalgia is an autosomal dominant neuropathy. If you like content, please press like and subscribe button. All the best!